lay my life down at your feet. You're the only one I need. I turn to you and you are always there. In troubled times it's you I seek. I put you first, that's all I need. I humble all I am, all to you. One way, Jesus, you're the only one that I could live for. One way, Jesus, you're the only one that I could live for. You are always, always there, every hour and everywhere. Your grace abounds so deeply within me. You will never, ever change. Yesterday, today, the same. Forever till forever beats for me.
Thank you, God. Jesus. Folks, welcome to Christ Church at the Grove. Amen. Good to see each and every one of you as I look around. And I want to thank Justin for ministering last week. Amen. On transformation. And I'll actually reference that a little bit more later. And you guys, before that, what was Pastor Ben preaching on? Very good. Amen. That someone said, right, biblical sources of motivation. Amen. It'd be interesting if I had the time, which I don't, to walk around and say, why are you here today? Why are you here today? What is it that's still drawing you? Amen. Because I can see you. I know you're a natural being. There's a part of you on a little bit of a cloudy Sunday morning that could have just stayed in bed. But something giving you enough reason. And I'm so glad for that. Jesus. Folks, we believe that Jesus is the way. He's truth and he's life. Amen. Where else could you possibly be that would be better than being here today on the Lord's Day? Amen. We have come to believe, Peter said, and to know that you are the Christ and that you have the words of eternal life. And that's why he was still going to hang out with Jesus when everybody else was leaving. Amen. I'm glad that you were able to think of at least one good reason, though we gave you a number of them. Right? Hallelujah. So before I pray, let me just make a couple quick announcements of some of the wonderful ways in which we served Christ this past week and mean to serve him in this upcoming couple of days, couple of weeks. Starting with a thank you. Amen. A thank you primarily to James and Mary Lou for their participation in our brothers and sisters down the road at the Vineyard Church at the Barn. Yesterday they held a fall festival over there, and there was various vendors, and James, I'm not sure how he connected, I guess through Lenny probably, right? Yeah. And nonetheless, you guys, they took that opportunity to have a fish fry, which was free, with a suggested donation. I mean, that's a good move. So James, what did you tell me it raised? $1,700. Amen. You guys, to support their ministry of feeding the less fortunate in a couple of homeless shelters around our area. Isn't that awesome? Amen. So I want to thank James and Mary Lou, but also when I went, I saw some of their helpers. And I'm not going to call them out by name because I don't want to take away their reward in heaven. But to me, that was so inspiring. And you got to meet some nice brothers and sisters in Christ that are locally around us. And that's always, you guys, a team spirit. Hallelujah. We're not in this by ourselves. We will be, I believe, taking up a special offering November the 14th. I know that some of you would be receiving literature from Wilmington, maybe from Lancaster, about places doing special meals around Thanksgiving. If God directs you to pull on your heart for any specific ministry like that, you guys, that's fine. We are connected to Lighthouse Youth Center. That's one of the ministries we support monthly. And this time of year, they have two major fundraisers. You're invited to attend their auction, which this year they plan to have at the Youth Center. But that's going to be on November the 13th. There's actually brochures on the back table about that auction. All right. For Thanksgiving itself, they try to, for some of their needier families that attend Lighthouse Youth Center, they do a turkey meal basket. And it is, they ask us to contribute towards putting those together, and any surplus is, I believe, just goes towards their fundraising effort. So it kind of does two things at once. So we're going to try to make it easy for you. If you're interested in trying to help some local families around Thanksgiving time, primarily through a basket of turkey and the fixings, we will be doing that through Lighthouse Youth Ministry, and our part will be simply to contribute financially. We'll keep our ears open in case they need help putting baskets together. We'll let you know. But again, you guys, you're not obligated. You know, we contribute to them regularly. Our ladies, help them on a regular basis. But it'll give us an opportunity if you feel so led. Okay, so on November the 14th, we'll take up that special offering. Anyone interested in participating in our commitment series? This is it's an 8-week study for an hour per week, where we go through our two little booklets that are tailored to explain us to those that are new to our congregation. Okay? And it is basically, amen, the basics of Christianity. We want people to understand what it means to be planted in Christ, growing in Christ's likeness, connected to Christ's body, spreading Christ abroad. We'll explain what that means and how we do it. But that is basics of Christianity. And all of us ought to be real clear on the basics. Amen? Yeah. Amen. So if you're interested in that, even if you've done it in the past, but I've reached out to some of you. Lisa, this is what I was talking about months ago, okay? Please let me know of your interest. It seems like the idea of doing it immediately after our Sunday service from about 12 to 1 or quarter, or 12 to 1, yeah, quarter of 12 to a quarter of 1. Starting October, and it's written down there, the 24th. Okay, so at this point, think about it, pray about it. Let me know if you've done it in the past, but you want to have a refresher. You'll benefit more from the second time around than you did the first time. Okay, so with that, youth leaders, our meeting is on the 26th, upcoming, and that is, amen, some of the things that we need to be aware of. Folks, now we're going to focus in on connecting with Jesus Christ. Amen. That's why I've come. And I've got good news for you. Jesus is more eager to meet with you than you are to meet with him. Jesus is more eager to meet with you this morning than you are to meet with him. Amen. He died so that this could happen. Hallelujah. So you draw near to him, he'll draw nearer to you. Amen. Let us pray. Precious Lord, we thank you, dear God. Thank you for this past week's activities, Lord, and all that you're doing for us and through us and to us, Lord, outside these four walls. But Lord, here at the beginning of a new week, on what we now designate the Lord's Day, Savior, we choose to gather here collectively. Lord, I thank you for waking every one of us up. I thank you for the measure of health that we have that allows us to be here together. But Lord, may we recognize, dear God, that you are more eager to meet with us, Lord, than we are to meet with you. And that's true every day. So Savior, I pray now that you would help to minimize every distraction, Lord, externally and internally. Satan, we're going to acknowledge that your job is to distract us. But we're going to stand strong in Christ Jesus. Lord, every person here has some area of need in their life. Lord, all of us have a lot to praise you for. Savior, above all else, we want to bless your name. So, Lord, we dedicate ourselves in this time now. Lord, whether we are more expressive or less expressive, whether we like to stand or sit, Lord, however it is that we connect with you, dear God, I pray that everyone would sense a freedom, Lord, to do so as we sing the songs of Zion, dear God, and we worship you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
How lovely This is This is the air I breathe. This is the air I believe.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, thank you, Jesus.
Bless you.
Praise God. Folks, Jesus told us that we were to love God with all of our heart, all of our soul, all of our mind, all of our strength. Amen. Every so often I catch myself asking, Lord, am I loving you that way? Am I focused upon you that way? In other words, with all of me. And it is a challenge, is it not? Amen. So many different things do pull on us. You guys, we're going to approach the Lord in prayer. And I would that you would agree with the psalmist, I believe, who said, whom, Lord, do I have in heaven but thee? Amen. That whatever your need is today, or need that you are aware of, your great hope really is Jesus Christ. And because of that, we sing, here's my heart, Lord. Here's my soul. Here's my mind. Here's my strength. Amen. It's the best thing that you can do for these situations is to truly just fall upon the rock, be broken even, and then say, Lord, have your way with this. And I'm going to trust you. Amen. Amen. So with that, let us pray. Amen. Precious Lord, thanking you, dear God, for our time of worship. Thank you for the worship team. Lord, they can't make us worship. They lead in worship, and we choose to follow. Savior, thank you for your Holy Spirit, your holy presence, oh God, that has ministered to me already here in this place. And Lord, but again, majority of our lives happen outside these four walls. And Savior, there are names and circumstances and situations, Lord, that though you know them, even before we ask, you have told us that we should ask nonetheless. So Lord, in faith, dear God, right now, Lord, we begin to call out, Lord, in our hearts and our minds, or even in our mouths, Lord, people and places and things. Lord, things that affect us all. Lord, we continue, dear God, to pray, Lord, for our world condition. Savior, with continued threat of COVID. And Lord, many other things that a lot that we're not even aware of. God, it's been that way always. Lord, just sometimes some are more in the forefront of others. So, Savior, we join our faith, dear God, with the faith of many believers, Lord, around the world that are invoking your name and your power. Lord, that this disease would be, this virus would be eradicated. And Lord, we pray, dear God, for our schools, their personnel. Lord, all of our institutions that involve many people. Lord, what can we do but keep trusting you? Lord, even while we're thankful that we can gather here, Lord, even then we say, Lord, protect us all. Savior, we have individual needs, Lord, both for personal and just within people within the circles of our lives. Lord, I pray a blessing, dear God, especially upon Joyce and Harry and their family. Lord, as I believe today, they begin to travel south, Lord, for an extended season of training, Lord, which will hopefully lead to, education, greater education, job opportunities. Lord, we love them. We ask your traveling grace, your protection, let your angels encamp around about them and their lovely family, Lord, till we're able to see each other again. Lord, for little Nate Sangster, dear God, that isn't feeling well. And Lord, I pray, God, that you would touch his body, Lord, that he would recover, Lord, from whatever his little illness is. Savior, we have many such like needs. Dear God, so glad that you hear us all individually all the time. Lord, may we support and encourage one another here today. Lord, help us, dear God, as we begin to turn our attention to your word, whether it be in a teaching mode or a preaching mode. Dear God, help us, Lord, to change, to transform, Lord, to live a little closer, dear God, to your ideal. Lord, thank you that you're merciful towards us, as all of us have fallen short of that in our past. And Lord, probably today we'll probably fall somewhat short. But dear God, may it be our genuine desire to live our whole hearts, soul, minds, and strength dedicated to you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Folks, again, by way of reminder, if you come prepared to give, the offering baskets are in the back, as well as the brochures from Lighthouse regarding the turkeys, basket meals, and also the auction. Okay, if you're interested in greater information on that, those are back there by the baskets. Amen. With that, I am going to dismiss children's ministry and youth ministry as they... Stop. Everybody stop 1 second. Oh, very important announcement. Listen closely. The cleaning crews is starting to notice a lot of like skid marks on these waxed areas, and they're a little bit harder to clean. So we're just asking you to be mindful. Help us out by noting if when you walk, you're leaving a scuff mark. And then we're going to ask you to change your shoes. Amen. If that's the only pair you have, you come talk to me. We're going to help you. But in all seriousness, it's making it a little bit harder on our cleaning crews. And we don't want to do that. Amen. And thank you. Okay, now go walking out. Watching for scuff marks as you walk. Amen. Okay. How many of you like cooperating? How many of you like, well, how about just cooperation in general? The idea of cooperation. I would say that most people are not against the idea of cooperation. How many of you are all right with the idea of you cooperating? Generally speaking, God bless you, because you know this could be a setup. You guys, today I'm going to be asking for some volunteers, okay, to help me illustrate what I'm trying to speak to us about. And you're going to cooperate. So I'm helping you now. Start praying. Oh, Lord, give me a cooperative spirit. Okay? All righty. You'll know when we get to that section. Right now, I want to read, if you'll turn with me, to Jeremiah chapter 8. Jeremiah chapter 8. Folks, this is one of the darkest times in the Old Testament in the history of the nation of Israel, because they are being overrun by neighboring powers. And some people will be taken away. And I'm talking about for like 70 years. So depending on when you were born during that time period, man, most of your life would have been lived in some foreign country under their oppression. 70 years is a pretty lengthy time. I'm not sure, you know, exactly here in chapter 8, just how long they've been experiencing some of the difficulties of the 70 years. But in verse 4, I know this much, that God says to Jeremiah, say to them, this is what the Lord says. You guys, we should always be interested in, this is what the Lord says. If you're reaching a point in your life where you're starting to feel like, I don't care what the Lord says. I'm tired of what the Lord says. I'm going to urge you to pray. Because that's indicative of a spiritual state which is not well. when you start leaning in that direction. Instead of saying, oh Lord, then speak to me. And help my ears to receive and my heart to receive. Amen? But there are circumstances that sometimes move us in that direction. But nonetheless, Jeremiah, tell them, this is what the Lord says. When people fall down, do they not get up? And the answer there is, as you read the context, the answer is yes, they get up. And if you stumble and fall, you get up. That's the thing to do. Okay. When someone turns away, do they not return? And again, I can tell you in the context of what we're reading, the answer is yes. So you were, you know, on a path, but you had a turn, but it's time to get back, if you will, to the path. Why then have this people, or excuse me, these people turned away? Why does Jerusalem always turn away? So he is putting a contrast. He's saying it's, you know, if a person falls down, they stand up. If they're going along a certain path, and then they need to turn around, but then they turn again and get back on the path. Jerusalem, why are you not doing that? They cling to deceit. They refuse to return. I have listened, the Lord says, attentively, but they do not say what is right. It's not like God has missed anything. Okay? But this is what's happening. None of them repent of their wickedness, saying, what have I done? How many of you have ever found yourself saying, what have I done? Folks, if that's a return to God, then thank God, that's called repentance. That's the beginning of repentance, where internally you acknowledge, I've gotten off the path. I need to get back. Jerusalem, the people of Israel at this point are being obstinate. Listen, each pursues their own course. Like a horse charging into battle. Folks, I don't know a lot about, you know, the equestrian field. I know that they say donkeys are stubborn. Okay, but then I've heard the explanation that little donkeys maybe are actually a little bit brighter than the big horses. You know, you can get a horse to run through a fire. They won't be too happy about it, but once you get them moving in that direction, and that's my understanding, that seems to be what's being implied here, they're more prone to keep going. A mule might just sit down on you quicker than a horse would. But the children of Israel, they are on this kind of a course where they see things their own way, and now they're charging into battle. And the bottom line is God is saying, change. Now, he contrasts the horse charging into battle with a stork in the sky that knows her appointed seasons. As does the dove, the swift, and the thrush, all different kinds of birds. They observe the time of their migration. But my people do not know the requirements of the Lord. You guys, this is the time of year, is it not? That we can look to the skies and start seeing that the birds know what time it is. That some of them have this built-in mechanism where they self-signal their awareness and start heading south, mostly for us. I saw a saying on a little desk calendar thing, and it kind of struck me. It said something to the effect that we can, well, you know what, I'm sorry, verse 20. Skip all the way to verse 20 of that same chapter. Because towards the end of this chapter, there's this lament by Jeremiah. And his lament is this: the harvest is past, the summer has ended. And we, talking about the people of God, the nation of Israel, we are not saved. It is a lament of passage of time, significant time, seasonal times. And they are still not any better. And that's where that verse, kind of surmises a little bit the children of Israel's condition. Other people, other animals, other things are willing to change, but the children of Israel are not, and consequently, salvation has not yet come to them. That little saying expressed this idea that we can accommodate the weather. But we must acknowledge the climate. That we must, adjust or accommodate weather phenomenon, but we must acknowledge the climate. And it is emphasizing these two things that sometimes we could almost use interchangeably. The idea of the weather versus the idea of climate. But it is stressing that there is a difference between those two, and that it has an impact. You guys, how many of you watch the weather? How many, right? I mean, you know you're going to watch the weather. If you're like me, I got the noontime news. I'm an ABC guy. Cecily Tynan, has told me the weather for many years now. Okay? And then I like to watch the 6 o'clock news and catch the weather. The weather, you guys, as that phrasing was trying to point out, are the smaller or the more minor daily changes in temperature, in things like precipitation, atmospheric pressure, humidity level. That's weather, as it's being used in this sentence. And it is talking about how we can accommodate the weather. And that's why we watch it. Amen. As I looked around, as you were coming in today, I saw more long sleeves. Not everybody, but okay. I saw more long sleeves. I see a little bit, a thicker material on some of you. I see some outerwear already on some of you. That is the way that we accommodate, because these are kind of minor changes from one day to the next, but we want to, we want to deal with them. As opposed to the idea of acknowledging climate. Climate has to do with more substantial differences that characteristically prevail in a region at a certain time. Okay, that's the distinction between the idea of weather, which is these little minor daily kind of observances, versus acknowledging some of the bigger things of a particular region at a particular time. Amen. We're now entering what season? Fall or autumn. Okay, I think both words are appropriate. Yeah. How many of you like fall? Cool. That's the majority of you. Awesome. I have a ranking system, you know, just for myself. You know, it goes like this now. At this point in my life, it's spring, then fall, then summer, then winter. That's the order of favorable to me. But it is an acknowledgement, at least in this neck of the woods, of how the weather pattern becomes substantially different. You guys, it's one thing to go from one day to the next where you've got these minor changes. You can accommodate that, usually by a little bit more clothes, a little less clothes, you know. It's important. It could impact any given day. I get that. But I'll tell you what, you best be clear about the idea of climate. That's more substantial. God bless my mama. You know, a couple years ago, she finally pulled the trigger on kind of a lifelong desire, and it's called live in Florida. I keep saying, Mama, look at the license plates. It's called the Sunshine State. Their climate is different. It's not the little daily weather changes. It's more climate based. How many of you have been out to the states of Arizona or New Mexico or Utah? How many of you have been privileged to go out to that part of the country? Amen. Several years ago, we went, my family and I, and my first thing was I sat down and I looked around. I said, what? The world is red and brown? You know, their climate is different. It's not just the weather. I'm sure they have fluctuation, you know, within their, but generally speaking, their whole world is a different color. And I actually, you know, it was fascinating to me, and I got to appreciating, you know, the beauty of the desert. You know, there was really Tasmanian devils. These little windstorms that you can see them just spinning around me, and it's like, what's that? Like Looney Tune guy, you know? And after a while, I was starting to catch myself marveling at the beauty of the cacti. In the various formations and size. But folks, you better be clear about this idea, because we accommodate the weather, these smaller changes. We must acknowledge the climate. In Matthew 16, first three verses, the Pharisees and Sadducees came to Jesus and tested him by asking him to show them a sign from heaven. And Jesus replied, well, when evening comes, you say, it will be fair weather for the sky is red. And in the morning, today it will be stormy for the sky is red and overcast. They knew there was signs in the skies, if you will. Because that's what they were asking for. And he's saying, hey, there's signs. You recognize them. These little daily ones, if you will. And they said, you know how to interpret the appearance of the sky, but you cannot interpret the signs of the times. You guys, I want to talk to us a little bit this morning about observing the seasons. Observing the seasons. That's what Jeremiah was decrying a little bit. That more significant time was passing. That anticipated change was not happening. But it was time for something to change. How many like my shirt? Doesn't it look like autumn? I don't know why. I didn't think of it at the time I bought it. I just like that little gold colored shirt. Now I look at it and it's just autumn. Folks around here, autumn speaks certain things. How many of you know that our foliage change is a little bit delayed this year? If you look and Google fall foliage change in Pennsylvania, the first thing it's going to tell you is it's delayed. A bit warmer summer, a bit wetter summer, and those leaves are holding on a little tighter. Okay? But how many of you know that in fall, them leaves are going to fall? How many of you are clear on that? I hope so. Or else you're not observing the times. I love the smell of fall. I anticipate a certain smell in fall. I like it. You know, it smells like leaves, I guess. I love to watch, you know, because it won't last long. You guys, not the actual, you know, peak of the leaves and the colors and the changes. If you let me tell you what I mean by acknowledging the climate. You have to be aware. It starts with that. Being aware. You know, God bless Mama. She wasn't quite as aware as she should have been about how the climate is in Florida. Accepting is part of acknowledgement, of true acknowledgement. You become accepting. You can say, I like to, you know, today, a little overcast, a little rain. But yeah, hey, just wait it out till tomorrow. Possibly. I don't know what the forecast is off the top of my head. With fall coming, a seasonal climate type of thing, I must acknowledge that the temperature's dropping and it's going to keep dropping. Generally speaking. Until it gets cold around here. How many like the cold weather? Hallelujah. Amen. I knew there were some of you. Yes. Yeah, now this, I see others of you going, no cold. You guys, part of it is accepting that in our neck of the woods, this is the climate. You can wish all you want. You're going to have to move if you don't want it to happen. Because it's the climate. You're aware of it, and then you must become accepting of it to the point of accommodating it. You will probably put on more clothing. You will probably, if you should, double check your heating system. This year, more than ever, you might want to do it sooner than later. Okay? All right, so amen. I just want to talk about that. Okay, here's where we cooperate with me, okay? You guys, I'm preaching about observing the seasons. This idea of some major thing, not the daily thing, even though that's a part of it. We live daily, you know, and it's part of it. But there's some global or bigger or major kind of changes. And this is not original by any means. As a matter of fact, I did this sermon, or version of it, 20 some odd years ago. And a couple people remembered. It struck them strongly. Okay. I'm going to move you by age. Over here is going to be spring. Over here is summer. Over this section is fall. And this winter. All right? You guys, average life expectancy is still around 80, though I just read for the first time in a long time, the average age expectancy in the United States this past year, well, I'm not sure what, has decreased. Okay. So we're going to go with the 80 number. All right? Now, real quick, you know, if you really don't want to move, I get it. If you want to move as a couple or you want to move as a family, I get that too. But generally speaking, if you're from age 1 to age 19, you're over in that section. And if you're not, you may stand and get ready to move because you can figure out this section, you guys, the summer is 20 to 39. 39, okay? The fall is 40 to 59. And 60 plus goes over by the wall. Uh-huh. Oh, yeah, Sal. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, get over there, Sal. Oh, my. Amen. Change your perspective. Meet the new people. Meet your peers. Hallelujah. Now, don't make me card you. I'll card you. You may be sitting. I want you to sit over there. I want you to sit. Amen. You guys, this is a way, and it's not original by any, this is a way of understanding life cycle. All right, now, okay. All right, Chatty Cathy's over there. Let me talk a little bit. Now, folks, understand, I thank God for our diversity of our church group. Okay, because so many of this section and this section is out there. Okay, but I do want to point out some things to these spring chickens. Don't you feel good that you're over this side of the room? I know I did the first time I did this. When I did this before, I was in this section. This section. The first time that I started thinking about, man, life's moving. And there's stages to this thing. And, you know, I saw this in my wife's vehicle, that our upstairs children's department, you know, is acknowledging that even within this major thing called spring, you know, these are the name of the rooms. There's a nursery room, right? There's a seeds. Let me get this in the right order real quick. Yeah. These are going to be the names of our class. There's a nursery up there. For those that are really, really starting out in this group, there is a seeds class where they're a little bit older and they're starting to get some things poured into them. Nursery, we just basically don't want them to get hurt. And we want them to have good memories of coming to church. Because they might not understand stuff, but they're going to remember how they felt. So if you ever work in the nursery, don't be mean. But then they get sprouts. That's the next classroom, right? The little seeds become sprouts. And these are technical terms of a tree growth. And then they become saplings. These are juvenile trees. Juvenile trees. You may listen as I briefly talk to them. You guys, this is kind of the beginning of life. Alrighty? And it is called sowing time. That's where life begins. with sowing. And I was young once. I remember. Matter of fact, as John Mayer said, I was so good at being young, I'm afraid of getting old. I was so good at being young. This is a precious, precious time. Childhood memories can only be made here. And I hope that you have some precious, though all of us also have hurts. Okay? You guys, one of the hardest things about this time in life is that the sowing is mostly by others. The idea of what is planted here in this group has a lot to do, number one, with God, who imprints things on us, does he not? Anybody, any parent who has more than one child knows that the two children from the same two parents are not the same. Stuff comes from God imprinted. I think that's so cool. But in addition to that, parents ought to be a big time sower. Because there will be other sowers, especially as these guys get to, from being, you know, seeds and sprouts to being more saplings. school. Oh, school's a big influence. Because it introduces them to peers. People in the same category that at some point they you know, there's a commonality, and you know what? They might listen a little bit more to some peers than they listen to the rest of you that are trying to pour in. Right? This is true of all of us. I recognize how much at the mercy of so many others this group is. That was true of all of us at one time. I thank God for keeping me. I thank God for making these people resilient. Because it's not all good what gets poured into them. But by the grace of God, you'll last and grow enough to enter another stage. Beautiful springtime. Okay, let me tell you, if that's sowing time, this is cultivation time. Cultivation time. Cultivation, you guys, puts you more in charge of your life. This 20 to 39 group. Your big task is to acknowledge that you're more in charge of your life. You can stay stuck lamenting what was poured in or not poured in over here. Or you can acknowledge that you're more in charge now of your life and that you get to pick and choose what you would like to water and fertilize or weed out. Right? I hope you're starting to acknowledge this season of your life called cultivation. Of the stuff that was poured in, what is it that you want to hold on to and grow more now? What is it that you want to not and maybe discard totally? And what is it that you did not get there that maybe you would like and you have to seek it out? And start a little late, maybe in planting it. But it is awesome that you're more in charge. Amen? Yes and no. Right? Because sometimes you wish somebody else was in charge again. You know, I wish I could be little. I could take a nap whenever I want to. That's what my daughter says, who's now a spring chicken. Summer. Right, she's more in charge, you know. Now she laments that those times we used to say, you can take a nap. You don't want no nap. Take a nap. You don't want a nap. Now she's more in charge, but life dictates that she can. She laments that. Okay. 40 through 59. Hello, people. I used to be among you too. Matter of fact, when I first did this and I was towards the tail end of summer, I was thinking, oh my gosh, I'm in with this group. Started thinking you guys are starting to show your age. God bless. And it was, you know, when I was like, yeah, a little scary, this is my next group in a couple of years. Well, hallelujah, now I'm over here. You guys are looking lovely. Lovely, all of you. Lovely. I love the way you can walk around straight and a little spryness to your step. And you guys, let me tell you, 40 to 59, this is, if that was sowing time, this is cultivation time. You guys, this is harvest time. This is reaping. Oh, reaping time. Do not be deceived. God's not mocked. What a man sows, that he's going to reap. Of the stuff that you chose, mostly you, you can keep blaming others and blaming life over here and bring it over into over here. But from my perspective, we're reaping what we sowed over there. But we just get to reap it now. The positives and the negatives. And you guys, don't feel too bad. All of us wish we could have a takeover. All of us wish we could have a takeover all the way to back there. Okay? This, you guys, is economically, you guys, unbelievably, this is the prime of life. Because of what you chose to handle well here, this age group is to be the most productive. That's what harvest is. You planted a couple seeds. Actually, a lot of people planted seeds in you. But over here, you chose to, which ones you wanted to emphasize and water, and which ones you wanted to get rid of. And now over here, hey, here it comes. In abundance. Usually in both directions. Positive and negative. Okay, again, this is not about kicking ourselves. This is about awareness. This is about acceptance. This is about accommodating. Handling well. So God bless you guys. Time to make hay. Time to make hay. Hello, my peoples. Hello, my peoples. You're looking lovely. Hallelujah. This is winter. This is the last season, because winter is, you know, the last season of the year. Okay? And hopefully this is about enjoying the harvest. It is a time of greater rest. Like it or not. Ready or not. It is time to enjoy the blessings. Amen. We can get nostalgic. Nothing wrong with it. Look, we got a past. We got a longer past than any of them. Let me also say that this group is so important in that in so many ways you have the most to offer. than in these other stages. And within us, in the latter stage, are part of the seeds that starts that next group. You know, I'm grandpa status now, and I'm so proud of it. But I look at my two little grandchildren and realize, man, I got to get to pouring. I got to get to pouring, you know, whatever I'm going to pour. In recognition, in acceptance, in accommodating the climate, the season that I'm in with you folks. So last week when Justin was speaking about transformation, and I so appreciated his gentleness. I don't know, but that stood out to me. Because it was a challenge. You guys, this is a challenge today. And the call was to change today for the sake of a better tomorrow. Someone phrased it this way: the only preparation you can make for the future is to handle the present well. And that's true. I've never been able to do anything about the future except in the day in which I live. That's encouraging. Because it looks a little scary when you clump it in big chunks like spring, summer, fall, and winter. It really makes it go quick. But we're all in the same boat. We just need to handle today well. But we do need to acknowledge, you folks are not them. These folks are not you. You are not them. You are in different climate zones of life. And it is good. Be thankful that you have progressed to where you are now. But as Justin was pointing out, understand there's things about tomorrow that each of us need to deal with. And this group, because in our society, in the way that we think of retirement and life enjoyment, it'll short circuit God's calling in your life. Thank God that you've reached this stage of life. But now you have the most to give. You also have the most to enjoy, potentially. You got to find the balance, because you are a Christian. You are still a servant of God. And to whom much is given, much is required. Amen. The harvest has passed, the summer has ended, and Jeremiah said nothing's changed. That's his lament. We're still not any better. Folks, we should be on a journey of better. From wherever you are, that's all. Right, Justin? That's why the word is better. Not everyone's mark exactly the same. Hey, man, our journeys have been very different. Their journeys will be very different. But with each passing season, dear God, help me to handle things daily in a way that they're better. And it's not over till God says it's over. Because that's Satan's lie. Amen? Alrighty. So I hope you're not discouraged. I hope you're encouraged. Okay? And we must keep handling today well, because that's the key. I'm going to pray. And I would that you would pray for yourself. I'm praying for myself. Lord, thanking you, dear God, for my life. Lord, thanking you for that springtime. Lord, I remember it vividly, and Lord, I've forgotten some. Lord, I thank you, dear God, that you made young people resilient. Lord, as I know, and all of us do, that we are poured into by so many, Lord, including you. And Lord, I thank you that we move into a summer season. Lord, when we begin for ourselves and our lives to determine with greater responsibility, greater privilege, Lord, the things that we want to cultivate. Lord, mindful, dear God, that in the fall we're going to reap. Lord, that's why I thank you for this, Lord. In my summertime, dear God, when I came to know you, Lord, I took it serious that I was going to reap what I sowed, though I didn't quite understand it the way I understand it now. Lord, thank you for this harvest time. Lord, the time of productivity. Lord, the time when things are going to get magnified. Lord, where things that I treated lightly, Lord, become a little bit weightier and bigger. Lord, that's a good thing if it's a good thing, and it can be a tough, bad thing if it was a bad thing. But Lord, that's how it goes. It will grow and multiply. So Lord, I pray, dear God, help these folks in the fall time of life. Lord, may it truly be a time of great harvest. Lord, that it might prepare us, Lord, for our winter season. God, and we can't believe we're in the winter season. It comes so quick. But Lord, if we divide it up this way, then we're in the winter season. But dear God, we are still here. Lord, with a wealth. Lord, in various ways, but all of us are wealthier than we've ever been. In experience, in wisdom, Lord, in potential resources. Lord, and we have a responsibility, because though there is a time of rest for us, we acknowledge, dear God, that it's our winter season, it's someone else's spring season, another generation, dear God, and we're the ones who have the most to give, the most to pour out, the most to pour into, Lord, the next generation of the kingdom of God. Lord, that's big. Dear God, that gives us purpose. So, Savior, help us on the daily journey where we accommodate the weather, the daily small changes. Savior, to acknowledge, Lord, the climate, these bigger seasonal type changes. And Lord, help us to be better, as Justin challenged us. Lord, help us to ask ourselves again afresh today, what is it that I can do different today? How is it that I should change my thinking that will make tomorrow better, Lord, for me, for others, Lord, ultimately for the kingdom of God. Dear God, that we might bring a smile to your face. Lord, I pray, dear God, that everyone here knows you, has committed to you. Lord, as that's the bedrock of every one of these seasons of life, is to be firmly planted in Christ Jesus, growing in Christ's likeness, connecting to the body of Christ, Lord, that we might spread Christ abroad. We pray in Jesus' name, amen and amen. Folks, mingle with somebody from another group, I guess. Or tell someone, I didn't know that. God bless you.